Now we are already on live, so and 7:30 is our starting time, so we'll start up. So good evening. This is the 22nd session of Exam in a Line, and today we have three faculty from three institutes. I will request Dr. Suchanda to introduce all three of them, and then Dr. Vivek will present the case. We have two cases. Dr. Suchanda, can you please introduce?
Okay. Good evening, everybody. So today is the 22nd session of exam online, and we have three esteemed faculties from three parts of India. From the north, we have Professor Ashish Suri, who is professor of neurosurgery at AIIMS and New Delhi. And then we have from the west, Professor Dattatreya Majumdar. He is from KM Hospital, Mumbai. And then we have Professor Dilip Panikkar from Kochi, from Aster Prime Hospital, Kochi. So, and we have three students, Vivek and what other two, Ashish and another name is Ashutosh and
Sheikh Mohammed,
right, from Madurai, Mumbai, and Lilavati, and Gurgaon. So we go ahead with the presentation, and there will be, as explained to you the other day, there will be one of you will present, the other two will be giving the summary, and then the professors will ask you questions, and that's how we go about both the cases, right? You take it as an exam and present it that way. Over to you, sir, Manas, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Vivek, you can share your screen and start your presentation.
Okay,
Dr. Majumdar, you want to divide them to 45 minutes, 45 minutes?
Yeah, 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 45 minutes, 45 minutes. That we discussed the other day, right? 45
yeah.
minutes is okay. So they present, are we going to sort of, as Ashish mentioned, that one presents and the other two summarize or something that we had, is it okay?
So that is means our way to just keep them. To keep everybody busy, all the three of them.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. No, I completely agree with that. I think the person who presents should present in detail, and the next person should summarize and do the localization.
Correct.
Based on the clinical, based on the history, and then the clinical findings.
Correct.
Like a long case. We'll divide it so that we should try to complete the presentation and the initial discussions by about 30 minutes. The last 15 minutes for the rest of the discussion on the case and on the pathology and the management.
Yeah. So, Manas, you let us.
So, you remind them at half an hour and 45 minutes.
No? So, you let us know the time so that we can then, after 30 minutes, you can let us know.
Yeah. I will let you know. I'll give the first warning bell at 30 minutes and so you can wind up.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
So even for the people who are presenting and analyzing, keep a note on the time, because this is your rehearsal for your exam. You have to be very conscious of time. Okay?
Yeah, sure.
So please follow
sure.
that. Okay.
Yeah.
Good.
I have only one request for the faculty, that normally many students who are in the audience, they keep on asking questions in the chat box and Q&A box.
Yeah.
If you look at it, intermittently look at it and answer them whenever it's
possible. Sure, okay. Will do.
So, Dr. Vivek, okay, sir. Start, right?
Shall I start, sir?
Yes, yes.
Okay, sir. Good evening, sir.
Yes,
good evening, my teachers, my friends. Today, I'm starting my case presentation. This is about a 57 years old female patient who is educated up to 8th standard and housewife, a right-handed individual and resident of Noida. History given by the patient herself, and the history is reliable. Patient presented with a chief complaint of non-progressive holocranial headache for last 10 years and complaint of progressive diminution of vision in left eye for last 10 years. Regarding history of present illness, patient was apparently well before 10 years. 1 minute, sir. Patient was apparently well before 10 years when she developed insidious onset dull aching, non-progressive, mild to moderate holocranial headache, which presents usually in the morning, and it is about 1 to 2 times a month, more in frontal region, associated with nausea and 2 to 3 episodes of non-projectile vomiting, which containing food particles, and it got relieved after vomiting or taking analgesics with no exacerbating factors and with no history of trauma or fever, rhinorrhea, lacrimation or photophobia and phonophobia. For this headache, patient went to local physician and referred to ophthalmologist for eye checkup. That time, patient first noticed decreased vision in left eye as compared to right eye, for which patient was given spectacles. Gradually, patient headache settled in few years and patient is not having any headache for last 2 to 3 years with no significant improvement in vision. For last 1.5 years, patient having progressive blurring of far vision in left eye rapidly in last 6 months, to the extent that she was not able to appreciate objects few meters away and not able to read letters while watching TV. Also, she was having difficulty in identifying objects coming from left side, associated with intermittent itching and watering in left eye. This loss of vision is not associated with redness or pain in left eye, not associated with bulging or retraction of eyeball, no complaint of double vision, no complaints of any visual problems in right eye, and no history of fever or trauma to eye, and no history of associated nasal complaints, and no history of loss of sensation of smell. With no history of loss of consciousness or seizures, no history of polyuria, polydipsia or menstrual disturbances, no history of enlargement of hand, feet or facial changes, and no weight loss or weight gain or skin changes, speech disturbances, no memory or behavioral disturbances, no history of any weakness or sensory deficits, and no history of bowel-related disturbances. Regarding past history, patient presented with a past history of trauma, stick injury to left eye twice in childhood, followed by swelling of left eye, but with no history of perceptible loss of vision at that time. And patient also having past history of pulmonary TB 10 years back, taken full ATD treatment, no history of diabetic hypertension or coronary artery disease, then no family history, any positive family history, and no allergic history now. So sir, to summarize my case, a patient, a 57 years old female, presented with complaint of non-progressive mild to moderate holocranial headache, more in frontal region, associated with 2 to 3 episodes of non-projectile vomiting and progressive diminution of vision in left eye with left temporal field defect without any diplopia and proptosis. Regarding the substrate involved, sir.
Yes. Now, let the other two people summarize whatever you have said.
Okay, first of all, for the other two people, who is going to be doing the summary? Who is going to volunteer to do the summary?
May I do it, sir? May I do it? I'm Dr. Yeah, Sheikh.
Okay, before you summarize, do you want to ask Vivek any further questions? Do you want to know anything more about this case?
Actually, the patient is having a unilateral diminution of progress.
No. Before you summarize, I'm giving this chance. Do you want to ask him any further questions, any doubts, any clarifications, any more information that you require?
Yes, sir. There is no
clarity. Because once you start summarizing, then you will not be able to go back to him.
Yes, sir. There is no clarity regarding the visual field defect. He says that there is a progressive diminution of vision in the left eye with a left temporal field defect.
Vivek, do you want to respond to this?
Yes, sir. So I have written that she was having difficulty in identifying objects coming from the left side.
He has mentioned about the field defect. So what more information do you want from the field defect?
Sir,
was if the patient is has been so specific, could you ask a direct question as to whether it was the temporal side, the upper part or the lower part?
Yes, sir. With respect to the horizontal and the vertical meridian, whether it has crossed the vertical meridian or the horizontal meridian, whether it is a hemianopia type of field effect or photo mass or
yes,
or a peripheral constriction of vision. Actually, this history is not giving a clarity regarding that.
Okay.
Let's say that this patient cannot give you any more information than this. Anything else you would like to know before you summarize?
There is a history of trauma at childhood. And is there any correlation with the past history, whether a patient had any deterioration of vision during the trauma incident? And
he says no. He was very clear about that. There was nothing.
Okay. And he gives a history of pulmonary tuberculosis. He may be on, the patient might have taken a full anti-tuberculosis treatment, particularly with the ethambutol. Any relation with any deterioration after taking ATT?
What do you want to know about if the patient is on ethambutol? What kind of vision? Visual loss?
Ethambutol has macular degeneration and optic nerve neuropathy. Optic neuropathy is one of the side effects of ethambutol. But that may be a bilateral. That may be bilateral.
Is there any specific visual loss that you would you encounter with ethambutol? Optic neuropathy and everything is quite common. It's a pathological thing. But anything which affects with ethambutol specifically, which type of vision? What are the types of vision that you would like to check?
Near vision, far vision, color vision.
Yeah, color vision. So ethambutol is concerned with which kind of vision? Just now you mentioned.
Color vision, sir.
Confirmed? Sure?
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Okay. So that history is probably not there. Probably that history may not be there. So assume that there is no problem with the AKT.
Okay, sir. And the headache history, it is not localizing. Sir. There is no localizing value with the headache.
You will just have to work with what you get.
Yes.
Okay.
So now you can summarize, I think. We can just summarize.
Yeah.
You have to go, if you're okay with whatever your, information is there.
Okay, sir.
Okay, let me try. Okay, Sheikh, you're happy with this information?
Yes, sir. I'll proceed, sir.
Okay. Can I ask one question?
Yes, sir.
Vivek, can I ask you one question?
Yes, sir.
Was there any hypesthesia or paresthesia over the face?
He said there's no autonomic symptoms like that.
So what is the importance then? If suppose it was...
Listen to the question very specifically. I said hypesthesia or paresthesia on the face. He doesn't have that history. But yeah, I think, Sheikh, why don't you go ahead and discuss it? Because then you will figure out how significant this question is, whether it is significant at all.
Yes, sir. Here is a 57-year-old patient with progressive neurological illness in the form of... diminution of vision in the left eye, and this is over the past 10 years with the non-localizing holocranial headache, particularly felt over the bifrontal region. There is no associated autonomic features like watering of eyes or nasal congestion or injection of the conjunctiva or any so this is just a non-localizing tension type of headache, which is present for the past 10 years. And there's no change in the character of the headache. and there is no danger signs of the headache like dysplasticity or
why do you say tension type of headache? On what basis do you say?
Because there is no autonomic symptoms. Patient doesn't have any autonomic symptoms.
Can I give you guys a word of advice? When you're asked a question, never reply in a negative. Do you understand what I mean? If you're asked, why is this not, why do you call it a stress headache? Don't start your answer by saying this is not something else.
Okay.
Say why it is. Why it is not something else becomes corroborative.
Okay.
But why do you call it stress headache? Why do you call it a tension type headache? Or what are the characteristic features of a headache that you will label it as a tension type headache? And how does it match with what this lady has?
Tension type of headaches is usually localized to the bifrontal region. It is sometimes it is holocranial, and it has a specific periodicity, and it occurs at a specific time.
Is there any diurnal variation? Is there any relation to any other thing? So
there is a diurnal variation. It is more in the morning, and as the day progresses, it eases out.
Is it?
Headache is.
Is it? For an average person, when are the stress levels likely to be lowest? Is it in the morning, latter half of the day, or in the morning, or in the early mornings?
Early morning.
A person with stress or some kind of a tension is most likely to be more comfortable in the mornings. The day progresses, the headache slowly builds up. And more than bifrontal, it is more likely to be bitemporal, occipital, sometimes coming down to the neck and the shoulders, can be exacerbated by activity, by interaction with other people, by speaking, and generally relieved on rest.
Yes, sir.
You understand? Now, yes. Come back to this lady and justify why you say that that you called it a tension type of headache. Also remember that this lady has had episodic vomiting in the early part. So you have to factor that in as well when you discuss the headache.
Yes, sir. Sometimes nausea and vomiting are associated with even tension type of headache, sir. And it should not be taken as a dysplasticity type of headache.
Is it relieved after vomiting? You have written here. So what type of headache relieves after vomiting?
An ICT type of headache relieves after vomiting, sir.
Then here we are talking about a tension type of headache. So is this relevant or
tension type of headache for the last 10 years? Dull aching, non-progressive, usually morning.
And headaches have got relieved after the correction of the refractive error. No? You have said the vision did not correct, but the headaches got relieved.
No, headache automatically disappeared, I think. That's what the next slide said.
The headache came down over the next year or two. Yeah. And then she remained fairly comfortable until recently, I think last 1 year, or last 6 months.
So it's just a headache which is non-consequential. What's the cause of this headache?
So Vivek, a question for you. How is her headache now? What is bothering her more? Is it the headache? Is it the visual impairment that's bothering her now?
Sir, for the last 2 to 3 years, she's not having any headache. Only the problem with the patient is the vision in the left eye. Diminution right. of vision in left eye.
Right. So, Sheikh, you also have to tell us, is this history of headache significant or is it something incidental, which the vast majority of people seem to have at some point of time or the other? I'm sure all of us have had our quota of headaches. So, is this related to the present condition, illness, or is it incidental? You have to tell us and convince us why you say so.
Yes, sir. I can hear you, sir. The headache can be attributed to the stretching of dura or any pain sensitive cranial structures like cerebral blood vessels or cranial irritation of the cranial nerves. And in this case, there is a patient is having an field defect. So I would like to think of a cellar mass that extends to the suprasellar compartment, causing compression of the optic apparatus. And since it has caused a stretching of the diaphragm cella, there could be a headache which is localized to the bifrontal region. And once it has come out into the suprasellar compartment, crossing the diaphragm cella, patient may experience a temporary relief of headache. And I'm not sure this is the process, but there is a possibility of this type of change in pattern of headache and patient getting completely relieved of headache. And this type of headache, initially it will be a localized type of headache. And once it has crossed the suprasellar compartment, compressing the the third ventricle and causing an obstructive hydrocephalus, this headache can turn into a holocranial ICD type of headache.
Okay, Sheikh, let's not talk theoretically now.
Yes.
Let's talk with relation to this particular patient. This patient has not had a recurrence of the headache. She is right now not bothered by the headache at all. Right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So, what you're talking is a very theoretical scenario.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Huh? See, yes, sir. Given a significant history of headache this patient had, you'll have to analyze it and tell us, what do you think this headache is? Is it related to the pathology that you told us or the sequence of events?
And is that a rule that if it crosses the diaphragm cella that the patient will not have any headache? It will be relieved of the headaches and there will be only visual problems.
No, it is just a temporary status and it is more theoretical. Sir. Most of the patient doesn't have this classical presentation.
Okay. Sheikh, let's go to your theory about this. Now, under what circumstances, under what specific circumstances will a patient with a cellar lesion have intractable escalating headaches which gets relieved? Under what anatomical situation will that happen? Does the anatomy of the diaphragm make a difference? Have any role in this?
Yes, sir. The diaphragm cella, which is inserting into the dorsum cella, if it is in an oblique angle, the tumor may seep into the clival region.
Ouch. No. Sorry, you completely missed the bus.
This is your interpretation or it is really given somewhere you have read or somebody has told you? You read it somewhere.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Can the third person take this question?
Yeah.
Who is the third person?
Sir.
Yeah, Ashutosh.
Yes, sir.
Bolo, do you want to hazard a guess about this?
Sir, in this stage, this headache history is not significant right now because the headache.
The question that I asked you.
Anatomy of diaphragm is in relation to the headaches.
Does it have any relation at all?
I don't think no.
No. Okay, let me ask you a question. You are aware of the types of diaphragm SLA, about the variations of the anatomy of the diaphragm SLA?
No, sir.
Have you heard of a closed diaphragm? Have you heard of a partially open diaphragm? Have you heard of a diaphragm that is... No.
No, sir.
See, the diaphragm need not always cover the entire cella with a small hole for the pituitary stalk. That is what anatomy textbooks say, but that is only one small part, and that is not very common. The more common ones are the diaphragm is partially incompetent or partially incomplete. And there is yet another form where the diaphragm is fairly rudimentary and the whole cella is open to the supracellular space. Now, a patient with a cellar lesion will have headache because of dural stretch only when you have a competent diaphragm or a complete diaphragm. That is when the intracellular pressure rises and your patient can have significant pressure. And this is what the situation that Sheikh described, when the tumor breaks through the diaphragm, that your headache can be relieved as the tumor gets more space to grow. However, in patients with an incomplete or incompetent diaphragm, they may not experience this kind of headache because there is enough space in the cella and in the supracellular compartment for the tumor to grow. Do you understand this?
Yes, sir.
So the anatomy of the diaphragm makes a difference to the patient's symptoms. So you have to try to factor this in.
Yes, sir.
Right? Now, pain that comes from a cellar lesion that is stretching the dura has a very peculiar nature. It is not always bifrontal. There is another component to it that adds on. Can you tell me what that component is? That's very important to know. It's not always just bifrontal. Anybody? No? It's a retroorbital pain.
Okay.
The patient will have a retroorbital pain, not just a bifrontal headache.
Okay, sir.
Understand, that is the classic pain that comes from a dural stretch. And why does that happen? What is the physiology behind that? What is the innervation of the basal dura?
It's by the ophthalmic branch of the trigeminal nerves.
So if you have referred pain, where will it go?
To the retroorbital regions. Okay. Anterior ethmoidal and the posterior ethmoidal nerve and the nasociliary nerve.
Exactly. So you'll have pain in and around the orbit.
Yes.
As opposed to a bifrontal headache, which is more related to probably raised intracranial pressure, but can also be non-localizing.
Yes, sir.
So when you take the history of headache,
okay, sir,
you should be very, very specific and ask very pertinent questions to differentiate these. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Hmm. Good. Go on, please. Sheikh.
And next, the patient developed a field defect. I mean, the peripheral field of vision, particularly on the left temporal side. Left temporal field of vision is affected. So, anatomically, the substrate would be the right nasal fibers. The nasal fibers are responsible for the temporal field, and there is a compression of the nasal fiber. I'm not sure whether it is a hemianopia or a altitudinal field effect. There's no clarity regarding that, and I'm not sure whether it is a temporal crescent or a scotoma, sequocentral scotoma. But he clearly gives this as a left temporal field effect.
But he has said that he cannot see the vision with objects coming from the left side.
Yes, sir.
So, what would a patient with a scotoma present, and what would a patient with a hemianopia present?
Yes, sir.
will the patient of scotoma say that he cannot see any vision, any objects coming from the left side, because it appears that it's quite a huge defect,
yes,
right?
Larger, yes,
defect.
So,
what will patient of a scotoma present?
Scotoma will have only a field defect in a particular region of the visual field.
So whatever
either
history, so on the history on this patient, you feel that it is scotoma or it is...
it is a field defect. I mean, hemianopia, sir. The patient is having hemianopia.
So where do you put the scotoma then? Would you put scotoma as an early sign or a late sign or what?
Scotomas are earliest signs, sir.
Ah, 1 minute, I'll come.
So patient is having both a diminution of visual acuity as well as field defect. So both the acuity and the field, visual field is affected with this patient, sir, without any diplopia and proptosis. So the 3, 4, 6 nerves are probably normal, and there is no
what is the neurological?
So the anatomical substrate that is involved is the left optic nerve, but that doesn't explain the nasal fibers coming from the right optic nerve.
From the right up.
No, sir. Patient is having a left temporal field hemianopia. So the nasal fibers should have been compressed or whatever, ischemic or any etiology. But if the left temporal field is affected, the right nasal fiber which has crossed would have been affected. So either it should be a right a chiasmatic lesion or a pre-chiasmatic lesion. This visual acuity is affected, so it is a pre-chiasmatic lesion probably. And this hemianopia doesn't explain.
Sheikh, if you have a chiasmatic lesion, would your patient very specifically complain only of a unilateral visual impairment?
No, sir. Yeah. I said it's a pre-chiasmatic lesion, sir, not chiasma. If chiasma is involved, the patient will have a heteronymous hemianopia, that is a bitemporal hemianopia.
Okay. So, are you talking of a possible homonymous hemianopia?
But the other half of the eye is not affected. There's only left temporal field defect.
Agreed. I mean, you don't know whether it's a purely left temporal field defect. Your patient has a general blurring of vision in the left eye.
Yes, sir.
And cannot see more on the left side. So it's a relatively more deficit on the left temporal side, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
See, if it's purely a hemianopia and your central field is intact, your patient will have no drop in the acuity.
Yes, sir.
The fact that your patient has blurring and very specifically says blurring means that there is a drop in acuity as well in the central field,
sir.
And that means a more anterior lesion,
yes,
as
sir.
Opposed to a more posteriorly placed lesion. Right?
Yes, sir.
What else?
So there is a problem with the visual acuity and the field effect. So visual acuity problem can be as a result of any refractive errors. Cause the problem starting with the retina, then the optic nerve, the intraocular part, the intraorbital part.
No. Shake. Let's not go theory in this. You know, when you talk of this, why are you talking of a retinal issue? Where does a retinal thing come in?
Because
when you discuss a case, you have to be specific. You have to talk in relation to this particular clinical situation, not theory in general. See, there are a lot of causes of unilateral visual impairment, but then what applies in this particular case is what you should be talking about. So
well,
in this particular
case, half an hour.
We have finished half an hour. See, time flies, guys. time flies. Okay. Okay. Quickly to summarize your localization. Tell us, left optic nerve?
Yes, sir.
Oh, left optic nerve with the impairment of the visual acuity and left temporal field effect, sir. Hemifield
effect. Okay, so left optic nerve. You're not talking of chiasm, right?
No, sir.
Yes.
No, sir.
You're not
I would talking like of to localize the lesion okay. pre-chiasmatic.
Okay. Now, is it a lesion in the orbit or behind?
I would like to take a differential diagnosis, sir. The lesion could be anywhere between from the retina to the...
In this particular situation, in this history.
Most probably a compressive lesion of the optic nerve, sir.
Where?
Etiologically, a compressive lesion.
Where?
Compressing the,
where along the nerve? Is it in the orbit, in the canal, in the intracranial space?
Probably in the canal or the intracranial space. The canal.
In the canal. Okay, why not in the orbit?
There will be a, if there is a lesion in, within the orbit, there will be a prop process or any restrictive eye movements will be there. Patient will have diplopia.
Agreed. Okay, so you say in the canal or in the intracranial space?
Yes, sir.
Okay, intracranial space means where?
Just after the exiting of the optic foramen to the chiasm, anywhere between that place.
Okay. Okay. Possible pathology?
Possibly an optic dural sheath meningioma or optic nerve glioma or impossible meningioma, which is within
57 year old lady with a 10 year history of headache and impairment of vision noted 10 years ago, which has been slowly progressive. More recently, it has rapidly worsened. Will you talk of an optic nerve glioma?
And headache.
No, sir. I will go more in for meningioma, sir. Dural sheath meningioma.
Optic nerve sheath meningioma. What else? Which other meningiomas can affect the optic nerve?
Any meningioma in the anterior cranial fossa, like orbital groove meningioma or anterior clinoidal meningioma?
No. Say again. What was that you said?
Olfactory groove meningioma.
Is the smell affected?
No, sir. It's not affected.
It's not affected. Then why do you say olfactory groove meningioma? See, what at your level, whatever you talk should be in order of relevance. The most relevant first. The less likely probabilities come down the line.
Okay.
So if your patient has an intact smell, will you talk of an olfactory groove meningioma with a unilateral visual impairment?
No, sir. It's ruled out.
Exactly. So the moment you say unilateral visual impairment, where does it take you? You said optic canal or at the exit from the optic canal. What other kinds of tumors, what other kinds of lesions can affect the optic nerve there? Sheikh, come on, quickly. We're running out of time.
Anterior clinoidal meningioma on the left side. Spinoidal meningioma, medial spinoidal meningioma.
Exactly. That is a more likely probability than saying an olfactory groove, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
See, the moment you say something like this, you're inviting diversion.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry.
Where does the visual deficit, visual field defect fit in on this?
The visual field defect doesn't explain this localization, sir. There should be a central field of vision loss or at least a peripheral constriction of vision. Probably a more clarity can come with the examination. We're still in the history level, so I'd like to do further examination of the
right.
what's the refraction?
With this much of history available, this is all you can probably localize.
Yes, sir.
Good. So Vivek, why don't you go to the examination findings?
Sorry, I just missed. Where has he localized ultimately on history?
Sheikh, why don't you tell localized? Dr. Mazumdar.
Localized in the intracranial part of optic nerve and the intracranial part of optic nerve, sir. The pre-chiasmatic lesion.
Okay. No, I'm just worried about your field defect on the history.
Yes, sir. With this localization, the field effect is not explained, sir. It doesn't correlate.
Means the history is not correct, or you would like to have more information?
Sir, maybe with a clinical examination, we can get more clarity, sir.
Can it be a cellar lesion?
Cellar lesion, yes, sir. The probability. Yes, sir. So, cellar, supracellar is a possibility, but there won't be any field defect.
There may be bilateral, but can it be the patient has noticed from one side? Patient might have bilateral field defect. One side more than the other. We don't know how the tumor is going and where it is going.
With the examination, we can come to a.
On the history, when you give a differential, are you only localizing to the optic canal and the pre-chiasmatic, or you would put the cellar, supracellar also in that list?
Yes, sir. Had it involved both the visual fields, I would have localized there, sir. Since it has not involved the other eyes, I'm not localizing it there.
Okay. The thing is, you cannot entirely rule out a cellar lesion in terms of being common. A cellar lesion going up is probably more common than some of the other lesions.
Yes, sir. Agreed.
You understand? You cannot rule that out completely. Yes, the fact is, you don't have a bilateral visual impairment.
Yes,
historically.
Sir.
So, it is less likely, but not completely improbable.
Yes, sir.
Go on, please.
On general examination, sir, general examination is normal with no neurocutaneous markers and no bulging or retraction of eyeball with no redness in either eye. Then higher mental functions are normal. Renal nerve examination on olfactory, bilateral sense of smell is normal. Then regarding pupils, both direct is 2 mm reacting to light, indirect is present. Then in visual acuity, in right without specs is 6/12 and in specs 6/6. While in left, visual acuity is finger counting at 3 meters and with specs is 6/60. Then visual field defects in right side, there is no visual field defect, while in left side, temporal hemi field defect is seen. And regarding fundus examination, on right side, it's the disc is normal. And while in left side, there is a disc pallor present with margin well-defined, vessels were normal and no exudates seen. Then oculomotor examination is normal with no nystagmus. Then other cranial nerve examination is also normal. And regarding motor examination, it's more or less normal.
Can you just describe the fundus again?
Yes, sir. Sir, in fundus examination on direct ophthalmoscopy, bilateral red reflex present, and on the left side, the disc pallor is present, the pale disc, then margin well-defined, and vessels over the disc is normal with no exudates.
Would you count the vessels?
Or hemorrhages. What's
that? Would you count the vessels? Over the disc?
Yes, sir.
What is the significance? especially in this. Examination sign is important here.
With normal vessels, means sir, any ischemic optic neuropathy is there or not?
So, what do you think? Is it normal fundus?
No, sir. Optic atrophy.
Which optic? Primary or secondary?
Sir, most likely primary. It's primary because the margins are well defined in it, and no shaggy margins or grayish.
What is the difference? Primary and secondary optic atrophy.
Sir, primary atrophy is due to the direct damage of the optic nerve fibers in the nerve fiber layer, or while secondary optic atrophy is secondary to disc edema.
Okay, so what do you see in the disc, and what do you see in the vessels, and what do you see in the periphery? In both.
In the disc, we see the cup, sir. Whether the cup is whether cup is elevated or not. Then in disc, we see the margins and the vessels in the disc coming out of the disc. Whether any obliteration of vessels is seen or not, or any cup obliteration.
Vivek, can I interrupt this? A cup, yes, is never elevated. The disc is elevated.
Disc is elevated. Yes, sir.
But the cup is deepened.
Deepened.
Okay, please remember that. Don't say cup also. The cup may be elevated. That's a wrong term.
Okay, sir.
What is the normal number of vessel count over the disc? Is there any difference in the disc atrophy or a disc hyperemia?
I think normal count is around 4 to 16.
Around about 8 to 12, 10 is the usual thing. It's something known as Kastenbaum sign. The number decreases in any atrophy. Hyperemia, it increases, and any atrophy, it decreases.
Okay.
What exactly is the main difference between primary and secondary? You talked about the disc swelling, and any difference in color?
Yes, sir. In the secondary, there is a grayish color of the disc.
And the margins?
And margins, blurry margins and grayish color found in the secondary optic atrophy.
Margins are usually blurred. There's more of
blurred, yes, sir.
There's more of whitish in the primary optic atrophy.
Yes.
So your diagnosis is a primary optic atrophy, right?
Yes, sir.
So the primary optic atrophy signifies that the nerve is?
That the nerve is compressed for long standing nerve compression.
It's directly compressed.
Directly compressed, yes, sir.
Does that correlate with your localization on your history?
Yes, sir, because the history of...
It does. It correlates.
History of 10 years is there, yes, sir. Blurring.
Okay. Okay, Sheikh.
Yes, sir.
Have you... why the visual fields... Can I... in the visual field, just the quadrants, both the quadrants are equally involved, the temporal, the upper temporal and the lower temporal.
Yes, sir.
Any other positive finding?
No, sir. Other than that, no positive finding in the examination.
So, how have you gained in your examination? Have your history become more specific? And has your examination contradicted your history or just made it more strong?
Sir, it supports the history that there is some long-standing pathology compressing the optic nerve.
Which part of the optic nerve? Which optic nerve?
Sir, it's more likely the extraconal part in intraorbital region.
Which side?
Left side, sir. Left side, medially.
Medially. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So, what do you think is the pathology?
And sir, long standing, most likely is the optic nerve sheath meningioma.
So, how would you investigate?
We will do first the ophthalmoscopic examination, sir, and then the MRI of the brain along with the orbit.
Okay.
See, Vivek, when you say ophthalmoscopic examination, it's something that you're supposed to have done. Yes. So I don't think you will say that as part of your investigations.
Yes.
When Dr. Suri asks you, how will you proceed with this case from your clinical diagnosis, you're supposed to talk about the relevant investigations. In which case, like you rightly said, is the imaging.
Can you
show us the
imaging? Yes, sir, imaging.
So your exact...
So what scan will you ask for?
Sir, we... mainly the contrast, T1 contrast, and along with the T2, we will investigate. To see the contrast enhancement, sir, whether it is there.
Brain and optic plus fat suppressed images.
What, sir?
Fat suppressed images of the orbit.
Fat suppressed.
Okay. Yeah, dikha, MRI dikha.
Yes, sir.
Show us the scan, please. Okay, the third person, Ashutosh.
Yes, sir.
Can you read the scan?
The other films you can scroll.
Just run through all the films what you have and then let Ashutosh read the scan.
Or bhi hai scan.
Bas.
Then wapas jao. You can scroll them slowly. Keep it here for a while. Is there anything there? Or?
Sir, one lesion. I'm able to see one lesion at the apex of in the middle, lower middle image. I'm able to see one lesion at the medial aspect of the left orbit. Near the apex.
Go to the next image. Niche jao. Anything? This.
Look at the image on the left. Look at the coronal image on the left. Is there anything that you want to tell us about that? Is there anything in particular that strikes you?
There is a hyperintense lesion of size approximately 1 centimeter. The left optic nerve is enlarged. The hyperintensity is noted in the left optic nerve when compared with the right side.
What is the relation of the optic nerve with the tumor?
Sir, I can't hear you.
What is the relationship of the tumor with the optic nerve? How is the displacement? You can scroll the images again. Scroll the first image, please. So it is, can you see the optic canal?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. There is a hyperintense lesion in the optic canal, sir.
Is enhancing at the orbital apex.
Yes, sir. It is enhancing.
Really?
And not sure whether this is a fat suppressed image, sir.
Why are you confused about that?
Intraorbital intraorbital contents are mostly fatty regions, so they can obscure the.
No, pathology. Why are you confused in this scan? What happens if it is not fat suppressed?
We may
what do you see in an image that is not fat suppressed?
If it is a lipoma, it will be
shake. If this image, the question was, is this image fat suppressed or not fat suppressed? So what is a very simple way to do that? Sir, what does fat suppression do? What does fat suppression do?
It suppresses the fat. So normal fat will be suppressed, and any pathological fat will be.
So where is the normal fat in this?
The intraorbital contents.
So is the intraorbital fat lighting up?
Not, sir. They are not lighting up.
No. So this is a fat suppressed image.
Yes, sir.
Can you go to the next one? The second one?
Yes, sir.
Now you can see actually all the scan, this one.
Yeah, the second image will show you the relation, no, of the optic nerve and the thing.
At least whatever images we've got looks like it's more displaced upward.
Yeah, it looks like it's pushed up.
What I can make. I think it's up and the nerve is put, the tumor is more medial. And
Can you mark the tumor for the viewers? Because somebody has asked to mark the tumor. Who are Vivek? Huh? Just,
yes, okay. Sir. This one, sir. Okay. And in this is the.
Yeah. So where is optic nerve in that thing? Where is optic?
This one, sir.
Okay.
And in this.
Okay.
What do you do with this? 57-year-old. How do you approach? Will you operate or will you give radiotherapy?
Can I answer, sir? May I answer?
Yeah, please.
Yeah.
This lesion is less than 1 centimeter. So, since it is compressing the optic nerve, we can go in for a stereotactic radiosurgery. Since the lesion is less than 3 centimeter, we can go in for a stereotactic radiosurgery. We can localize the lesion and give a radiation.
You will nicely burn the nerve. I think that's what you'll do probably.
The surgery will be the best.
Low dose SRS.
See, there is no low dose SRS. SRS is SRS.
Yes.
You are delivering a concentrated dose of radiation to the structures involved. Now, your optic canal is a tiny structure there. The orbital apex, optic canal, and the intracranial space around which the lesion is sitting is a very tiny space. And in that space, if you want to mark out the lesion and precisely deliver radiation to that, it's going to be very difficult while sparing the optic nerve. Second thing is, when you deliver radiation to a lesion like this, what happens to the lesion? What can radiation do to the lesion in the acute, in the immediate phase?
It can further worsen, sir. It can cause edema. Necrosis.
Exactly. You can get edema developing within that and some swelling. It may be transient, but when your lesion is confined within a very, very narrow space, you can cause irreversible damage to the structures that are adjacent to this purely by the swelling. So what could have been a retrievable situation will become irretrievable. So in this particular situation, from the size criteria alone, yes, stereotactic radiosurgery. But the important thing here is not treating the lesion, but protecting vision.
Yes.
So then your approach should be different. Your approach should be to decompress the optic nerve, relieve pressure on the optic nerve, first and foremost. Second, remove the lesion. You understand?
Actually, yes, I would go for a repeat MRI and get proper, a much more better, yes, MRI, because this lesion, as this MRI, I would not like to, because the problem with this lesion is it is very close to the annulus of Zinn. So we, yes, we don't want to save the optic nerve but make her ophthalmoplegic from one side.
Exactly.
So, and I would like to have a good MRI of the orbit and of the brain and see whether this lesion has some bit of intracranial extension and how much intraorbital extension is there. And if it is going into the orbit, is it involving the annulus of Zinn? That means, is there any N-plaque component around the optic nerve? If that is the thing, then probably surgery is required. But the extent of surgery will depend on a proper MRI. If the lesion is well localized and is going in at the carotid cave, near the carotid cave and compressing the optic nerve, then the best would be to do an extradural ACP drilling, then open the falciform ligament and deliver that lesion. If it is going into the orbit, then probably we should be a bit conservative at the annulus of Zinn and maybe just decompress the one which is just entering into the orbit so that the eye movements are retained. But we have saved the nerve. So there are two things there: the annulus of Zinn, which is important, and the ophthalmic artery, which is important. We don't want to have damage the artery and make the patient blind. Actually, any suggestions or points of opinion, Dilip or Lata?
Yeah.
No, I completely agree. I completely agree with what you say.
Correct. I think that radiosurgery seems to be a very 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 easy option in this. But you can burn your fingers in this, and already compromised vision and increase in the edema. It is a very easy and safe option to do. But as what Dr. Surya and Dr. Panikkar are saying, I think drilling and de-roofing the optic canal and releasing the pressure on the optic nerve, I think seems a very very plausible option in this, definitely. And then removing whatever you can safely. This is a slow growing lesion, so at least you have saved the vision and saved the other structures, and you can give a good whatever. She's 57 year old, so it will take another 15 years to grow probably if it has to.
Exactly. Chalo. Good.
Yeah. Can we have okay. Because I think
let's go on to the next case. I think we are getting signals to move on.
Yes, sir. I think we can go to the next case.
There's one question there are some questions in the panel.
Yeah, any endonasal decompression, any endonasal endoscopic decompression.
I do it for tuberculum cellae, but anything which is going beyond, it seems to be involving the annulus and also maybe going a bit lateral.
Yeah.
So I'm more better in these cases.
Microsurgical.
For tuberculum cellae, I do endonasal, but not for this. What do you think, Dilip? Would you try an endonasal in this?
You're muted. Dr. Panikkar, you're muted.
Dilip, you're mute.
Oh, sorry. I think, yes, endonasal is an option that we need to keep in mind, but case selection is important. I think before you even consider that, you need to know the relationship of the optic nerve and the lesion. And for that, you need a very good quality MRI, very thin section, good quality MRI, and a CT, which will tell you all the anatomy that you need to know. Purely decompressing the optic nerve, yes. If the lesion is medial and abutting the lamina or abutting the medial part of the canal, yes, this is an option.
Very good choice. But not for complete extension.
This looks like an orbital apex. So, I think this is not very suitable for endonasal probably.
No, this is not going to be suitable for endonasal. For decompression of the nerve, yes, it's a good option.
Yeah.
But for removing the lesion, I think you have to be very careful and look at the imaging very, very carefully.
I think I'm going to have the next case because I think we are running short.
Yes. Who is presenting?
Yeah, myself, sir.
Okay. Good.
One second.
Have to share your screen, right?
Yes, sir. Can you see my screen, sir?
No, we don't see.
No.
Maybe your video is, I mean, video is not coming in.
Yeah. One second. Can you see me?
Yes. Yes.
Yes. So this is a 28-year-old male patient, Mr. X. He is a painter by occupation. He is coming from Virudhunagar, Tamil Nadu, who had studied up to 12th standard, presents with complaints of progressive loss of side vision in both his eyes for the past 3 years, blurring of vision in the left eye for the past 3 months, cosmetic disfigurement of the face, and physical changes in his body for the past 3 years, and headache for the past 2 years. History of present illness, patient was apparently normal 3 years back. He developed insidious onset, gradually progressive neurological illness in the form of visual field defects in both his eyes, with history of frequent bumping into walls, door, and people while walking and crossing the road. He often met with motor vehicle accidents and found difficulty in parking the vehicles, negotiating obstacles, and noticing other vehicles at road junctions. This visual field defect progressed from above downwards, and he came to know that when his fellow painters told him that his paintings on the wall were irregular and incomplete in the top and corners of the wall. Now, patient is having blurring of vision in the left eye with difficulty in identifying the color contrast of objects for the past 3 months. There is no history of any pain in the eye, bulging of eyeballs, redness of the eye, watering or photophobia. There is no history of double vision, drooping of eyelids, restriction of eye movements, or abnormal deviation of eyeballs, or any involuntary oscillatory movements of the eyeball. Patient then developed cosmetic disfigurement of his face in the form of coarsening of facial features with the disproportionate enlargement of his hands and feet, with the history of tightening of wristwatches and his rings, with the history of increasing footwear size from 9 to 12. He also has complaints of sweaty palms and greasy skin, with change in his voice for a period of 3 to 4 years. There's no history of any abnormal nipple discharge, swelling in the neck, heat or cold intolerance, palpitations, tremors, anxiety or depression. There's no abnormal weight gain, abnormal pigmentation, purple striae over the flanks of the abdomen. There's no easy flexibility or any abdominal pain. There's no history of any impotence, erectile dysfunction or loss of libido. Patient also had a history of non-throbbing headache, mild to moderate in intensity for 2 years duration, which was felt over the bifrontal region, which lasted for 2 to 3 hours with no specific periodicity and aggravating factors. Headache was not associated with vomiting or cramps in visual obscurations and visual floaters. He had 2 to 3 such episodes in a week, and he gets relief of headache by medications. Patient has not experienced any such headaches for the past 6 months, and he got relieved of it completely. There's no history of any autonomic signs. There's no history of any increase in frequency or quantity of urination. There's no excessive thirst or overeating. No history of cough with expectoration, hemoptysis, weight loss, or loss of appetite. There's no history of any behavioral abnormalities, altered sensorium, memory, or language disturbances, or any abnormality in perception of smell. There's no history of abnormal or decreased sensation of the face or difficulty in chewing. There's no facial asymmetry, difficulty in closing the eyes, taste disturbances or dryness of the eye. There's no hard of hearing, buzzing sense in the ear or giddiness. There's no nasal regurgitation of food, difficulty in swallowing or hoarseness of voice. There's no history of drooping of shoulders or difficulty in neck movements or turning the head side to side. There's no difficulty in marshalling the food, difficulty in speech, articulation of speech. No weakness of limbs or sensory disturbances, bladder bowel disturbances. No history of any involuntary movements, no history of seizure, fever, neck stiffness, and recent vaccinations. Past disease is not a known diabetic, hypertensive, epileptic, asthmatic, or heart disease patient. He had consulted an ophthalmologist for the above said complaints. He was asked to do MRI brain and then referred to government hospital for evaluation and further management. Personal history, he is married, he has 2 children, he takes mixed diet, he is non-alcoholic. He was never hospitalized before. There's no history of any previous surgery. Family history, it was not contributory. There was no similar illness in his family or any familial endocrinological cancer syndromes. Shall I summarize the history, sir?
Please.
Yes.
So this is a 28-year-old male patient with insidious onset, gradually progressive neurological illness in the form of visual disturbances affecting the field of vision in both his eyes, which progressed from above downwards, that is a bitemporal hemianopia, and reduced visual acuity in the left eye for the past 3 months, with the impairment of color vision for the past 3 months, associated with the cosmetic disfigurement of face and physical changes in the body, suggesting an endocrine abnormality of growth hormone excess, with the localized bifrontal non-ICD type of headache, with no recent change in pattern of headache, with the normal higher mental function.
Your audio is not there. We lost your audio, I think.
Sriram, any problem?
I think he lost his audio. Audio probably lost. I think he's lost.
Sriram, can you call him up?
Yes, I'm calling, sir. Yes.
Okay,
while we are waiting for him to come back, Ashutosh, are you there?
Yes, sir.
You can summarize.
Yeah. Do you want to talk about this? Do you want to give us some your thoughts on this?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. According to history, 28-year-old male with complaint of bilateral visual disturbance, basically superior to inferior aspect, involving temporal field, and there is no evidence of endocrinopathy, with classical feature of facial disfigurement, enlargement of fingers, enlargement, change in tooth size, and
what did you say? There's no history of there's no features of endocrinopathy.
There's no history of weight gain.
Think before you talk.
Yes, sir.
Soch ke bolo.
Okay, sir.
You said no endocrinopathy.
अगर spot diagnosis बोलना है तो बोल दो कि ये spot diagnosis है.
ये कोई long case नहीं है, ये तो spotter है.
Spotter है, ये और क्या है तो.
Sir, according to history, it looks like acromegaly.
तो ऐसा बोला
ना. तो तुम endocrinopathy नहीं है, क्यों बोल गए हो?
Sorry, sir.
ये classical spotter है.
Yes.
Spotter is not a long case. Neurologist or neurosurgeon to decipher the diagnosis. This is a spotter. Along with now you can the summary of your findings. Now you can fit and relate there.
Yeah.
And now you can select.
Why you tell us the what acromegaly and what is the problem with the patient?
One quick question. Is this a microadenoma?
It's microadenoma.
Why do you say so?
Acromegaly generally present with macroadenoma.
Why? No.
And the involvement of vision. And involvement of vision. vision environment.
ये patient में बोलो ना.
Involvement of vision according to vision.
अरे यार देखो, don't get thrown off by the odd question. There'll be one slightly tangential question that will come at you. The answer can be very straightforward. Don't get thrown off by the question. Okay. ये हमेशा exam में होता है. So be prepared for this.
Can you describe the involvement of the optic apparatus? Which part of the optic apparatus has been involved and how?
Bitemporal involvement suggestive of lesion is around the chiasma. Optic chiasma, macroadenoma involve optic chiasma, which give the bitemporal hemianopia like a field effect.
So the very nice statement I saw that the vision was involved from
upper. Because optic chiasma, inferior chiasma contain the inferior nasal fibers which give a superior field effect, which is already explained the history, field involving from superior to inferior. So it indicate lesion coming from the downwards, below the chiasma.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now the boss has come.
Can I? Yes, I joined. I'm so sorry because I was held up.
Yes, sir.
I saw
this this person's history, and this Madurai fellow did very good case presentation, but this Ashutosh, he was sleeping. He told there is no weight gain or something. He started like that. And I don't know what he was listening. But, you know, how can he tell whether this is a Jaijandism or a acromegaly? Whether this, how he will make out from the patient? Whether it's a Jaijandism or a acromegaly? Whether it's a giant or a acromegaly? Both are different.
Yes, sir. Yeah. This is acromegaly, sir.
And what is your inference? What is your inference from that? This fellow is 27 years old. Oh. Understand? First, you should tell what is the difference between a Jaijand and an acromegalic patient. And what is the inference from that you get? And then tell how will you make, how will you differentiate one from the other?
Jaijandism includes if growth hormone appear before the puberty, then vertical length increase. But this patient has...
Man, you just tell slowly. You are correctly answering. So, what will be the finding differentiate acromegaly from a Jaijandism fellow?
According to
this stories, fellow is 27 years old. Have to tell whether this illness has started before the closure of epiphysis. That is the answer, man. So how will you find out?
Because the changes in the shoe size.
What shoe size and all? Both the fellow will have very large shoes, man. Both no. Giant and acromegalic will have large shoes. The earring this. Rings will not be, they cannot wear the rings like that. But how will you differentiate clinically? So if it is a giant, problem has started.
Acromegaly patient has more facial features, including...
Okay, you are continuously telling wrong answer. Then Madurai fellow has come back.
Yes, sir. I'm there, sir.
You are the Madurai fellow?
Yes, sir.
Very beautifully you presented, man. Nicely you, presented. And you tell what is the difference. How will you differentiate a giant from acromegaly?
Here, there will be enlargement of the acral part, sir. Mostly enlargement, abnormal enlargement of the hands and feet with the coarsening of facial features.
And that will be there for both, man. If growth hormone levels are high, everybody will have all these coarsening features. Everything that feature will be there for both the times, man. So I am not going to tell the answer, man. Go and read, man. Okay,
sir.
General height of the patient will increase.
Somebody is answering something from question and answer. I am not sure. But you are incorrect, man. Correctly, this will be asked for exam, man. Okay. It's a basic thing, man. I don't want to give that answer. Normally, I give the answer. Because if you... otherwise, you won't have that inclination to read also. Go and read. Okay. Okay.
What was the age of the patient at the onset of symptoms?
What, sir?
Not getting a voice, sir. Voice is not clear.
Sorry to interrupt, sir. Dr. Sheikh is there. Shall we share the PPT again? We have not...
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, please share it again, please.
Yeah.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
You want me to go back, sir?
No, I'm asking you, what is the age of the patient? 28 years old.
28-year-old, sir.
When what was the age when the symptoms started?
4 years back, sir. It was 28 years old.
So the patient was 24 when the symptoms started. Automatically, your growth hormone excess became after the epiphyseal closure. So this is acromegaly. That was what Dr. Suresh Nair was had the symptom that started 15 years ago. Where suppose there would have been another patient in which the symptom would have started 15 years ago at the age of 13. Then it would have been a gigantism. Very, very simple.
Yeah.
Acromegaly will be happening in both. The acral features will be happening in both. The height enlargement will be happening. The giant will be much, much, much taller. But that's
much taller. Yes. Long height.
Yeah. So your basic history can make a difference between a giant as a gigantism and an acromegaly. It's just epiphyseal closure. And the more the giant is, the taller is the heights. They are one of the tallest in the world and all those ones. And yeah. And they are more prone to have cardiac problems.
Yeah.
So how will examination be? We have 10 minutes left. Examination.
Okay. Yes, sir. So from the history, I would like to localize this lesion in the cellar and the suprasellar region. The anatomical substrates involved are the pituitary gland, the optic apparatus, the chiasm and the left optic nerve. With the etiological probability of a compressive mass lesion which had progressed from cellar to the suprasellar compartment, and my working diagnosis would be a functional pituitary macroadenoma, which is a growth hormone secreting.
So how will you now? Okay. Positive findings.
Yes, sir. His height is 5 feet and 9 inch. He weighs 78 kg. And this is the prior photograph of the patient before 4 years. And this is the present photograph. He has got a frontal bossing with the enlarged nose. Hypercilia is there. Macroglossia is there. He has a spade-like hands and spade-like foot. There is hypertrichosis in his leg and hands, you can see. And he has got an, there's no buffalo hump in the neck, no neck swelling or no abnormal discharge from the
positive
nipple.
Positive findings, positive.
Yes, sir. His secondary sexual characters are normal. Of the cranial nerve, second nerve examination, on the left side, his acuity was affected. It was 20/200. And the field of vision, patient has got bitemporal hemianopia. Color vision was impaired on the left side.
And, how did you check the color vision?
Sir, I just compared it with the hue of the red color.
Either you do not or you have proper Ishihara charts.
I have a Ishihara chart, sir. There are 14 charts of color plates there. He was able to identify only 4 plates.
Okay.
And he has got a relative afferent pupillary defect on the left side, which is 4 millimeter, and the right side, when relative to the right side, it is only 3 millimeter. Fundus examination, you have got a pale, dirty white disc on the left side, and the right side, it is yellowish pink and normal. The disc margins are normal, there is no blurring. The cup size is normal. The cup is to disc ratio is 0.3:1 in the right side, and the cup is very much pronounced in the left side, and the vessel calibers are normal on the right side, but it is reduced on the left side. The arteries to vein ratio is 2:3 on the right side. It is same here on the left side. There's no gliotic scars on the left side. Peripheral retina, there's no flame-shaped hemorrhages, cotton wool exudates. Macula is normal, and the foveolar reflex is normal on both the sides.
Very good.
Sheikh, can I ask you something? How did you measure the cup disc size? This is with your ophthalmoscopic examination, right?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Or have you used the, or is this the assessment by an ophthalmologist?
No, sir. It's just a visual interpretation. The cup is...
Because you have said, because you have given us some very precise ratios, 0.3:1 and 0.9:1.
Yeah, this looks a little bit... How do you measure? How do you measure the cup disc size?
Actually, with the slit lamp examination, we can measure that.
Did you do a slit lamp exam?
No, sir. I didn't do a slit lamp examination.
How do you know this measurement? 0.9:1 and 0.3:1.
That's what I'm asked. That's what...
theoretical value, sir. The cup is 30% of the size of a disc, sir.
No. Rest. I thought you did it with your stethoscope.
No, sir. I didn't do it, sir. It's just
do not do that.
textual interpretation. Yes.
No, this is, see, you cannot do that. Sheikh, whatever you say is something that you should be able to demonstrate to your examiner.
Yes, sir.
As to what you have seen. Giving measurement C, you say less than half, more than half, that is understandable. But say 0.3 to 1 ratio, 0.9 to 1 ratio,
yes,
and you actually measure arteries and veins. You say artery to vein is 2 to 3. I don't think I have seen.
I was so impressed that he's done a slit lamp. I thought he's done a slit lamp.
Exactly. Or this is purely a slit lamp exam.
The tabulation is also very precise. So it looks like
an ophthalmologist. This is not right. This is incorrect.
You cannot present it in an exam like this, because it will be immediately expose you. It will immediately expose.
Don't do that.
Okay, I'll correct it, sir.
The best thing about neurosurgical examination or neurological examination, you have to be truthful. Without knowing the diagnosis, without trying to even thinking about knowing the diagnosis, don't try to fit in things. And try to, I would not like to use this word, try to be over smart. Because that actually, anything in neurosurgery, maybe a general examination or taking a history or talking to the patient or even surgery. Don't overdo things. Even if you want to overdo things, I thought you had done a slit lamp yourself. So I was very impressed.
Exactly.
But this is not right. This is not acceptable.
Yes, sir. But I didn't do the slit lamp explanation. Sir. It was done
when
by
you,
an ophthalmologist.
When you cannot mention these.
Then it is even more. Then it is worse, actually.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry, sir. I'm sorry to put it in this way.
Yeah, but please remember this. When you present the case, it is entirely your assessment, not somebody else's assessment.
Yes, yes, sir.
You work bedside with an ophthalmoscope and you describe exactly what you see. We know that measurements are not possible with a standard bedside ophthalmoscopy.
Correct.
So, you just have to give a guesstimate. If you want to extend your neck that far and say that, yes, but you should be prepared to justify it at that point. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Good.
Even ophthalmologists don't do this in the
outpatient. Exactly. They just take pictures and send it.
Yeah.
Hey, but it can be done. It can be done if someone
it can
is
be done.
Good.
Exactly.
I thought he did it.
No, it's actually a good exercise for.
Yeah.
I mean, if you have a very good relationship with the ophthalmologist, to pick up patients once in a while, just take them to the ophthalmology and sit down with one of the younger ophthalmologists or one of the residents. Sit down with a slit lamp and actually understand. It's very educative.
Correct.
Very educative.
Okay.
Yeah.
Please proceed to your hardly very short of time. Next.
May I proceed, sir?
Please.
Yeah.
Please.
Anything positive more? Just I think
the automata cranial nerves, other cranial nerves are normal, sir. Spinomotor system is normal. And the endocrinological workup, there is a...
No. This is a clinical examination.
What is your diagnosis?
Diagnosis and what do you want to do?
This is a cellular suprasellar functioning pituitary macroadenoma. With the growth hormone excess.
How will you investigate?
See, actually, a step back. To say that your patient had acromegaly, your general physical examination, did you describe all the findings? You said a few of them. But Dr. Suresh had asked a very pertinent question. Is it gigantism or acromegaly? Are there any objective evidences to say whether it is gigantism or acromegaly?
Yes, sir. His height is normal, sir, within normal limits. It's 5 feet and 9 inch. And usually gigantism, it is more than 8 feet. And
There is a ratio that compares the arm span to the height.
Okay.
Look at that.
Yes, sir.
Look at that. Okay, go on. Your diagnosis.
It's a functioning pituitary macroadenoma with the growth hormone excess.
What?
With acromegaly.
With acromegaly, right? Yes, sir.
Okay, how do you investigate this patient?
I'll do a basic endocrinological workup and then.
What specific markers will you ask for?
I'll ask for a basal growth hormone level, fasting growth hormone level, and insulin like growth factor 1, and other hormones like basal prolactin level and diluted prolactin level. And then I'll go for.
Why diluted prolactin level? You will ask for routinely diluted prolactin level? Pooled prolactin, you mean? Routinely you will ask it, or if you are suspicious or something, then you will ask it?
Not required routinely, sir. Only if you get a falsely low value, and if the patient has a macroadenoma, such a huge tumor,
okay,
and the values doesn't correlate with that, I'll ask for a.
So you won't ask for a pooled prolactin unnecessarily, no? If you are suspicious of something, then only you will ask.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Then?
In the basal ACTH level and. Cortisol level, urinary 24-hour urinary cortisol level.
Most important is growth hormone, IGF-1, and another hormone level, because you're planning surgery, right?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Your cortisol will require that hormone level. No.
Thyroid. Cortisol and thyroid.
If you are subject to
it. You didn't say thyroid. Thyroid you didn't say, mention, right?
Most important. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
3 years duration with visual compromise may have a large tumor, may have an invasive or a macroadenoma, which may have a pressure symptom on the normal pituitary gland, and you would like to know whether the thyroid levels are normal or not. Why? Why do you need to know that? Anyone else?
Sir, because post-operative recovery is important regarding the thyroid level. We have to optimize the patient.
How many days replacement is required before you actually go in for surgery?
Sir, around 4 to 5 days.
No.
Around 4 to 5 days.
2 weeks. 2 weeks.
Two weeks.
Unless it is a pituitary apoplexy in which you need an emergency replacement. What other investigation? What are the most important investigation?
Serum cortisol level.
Yeah, cortisol level you mentioned, no?
Cortisol and
ACTH. Tumor dekhega na, kya karega?
What
investigation?
Chest X-ray and other radiological examinations, sir. Like CT chest or abdomen and retroperitoneal scans.
Anything for the heart?
No. We are right. You know the diagnosis now, clinical diagnosis. You want to reach to the final diagnosis. What is one investigation that you'll do?
Okay, when you ask to investigate this patient, why are you talking about CT scan, the abdomen and the and chest and the and X-ray chest? What is your diagnostic investigation here? You have two sets of investigations. One is your endocrinological assessment. The second is to establish whether there is any structural pathology. So what investigation will you ask for?
Hello, jaldi. We don't have time.
Echocardiogram to look for the status of the heart, because that is mostly associated with the visceromegaly.
Arey, beta,
No.
Will you do a brain imaging or not? Will you do an MRI scan of the brain or not?
Yes, sir. MRI brain.
That is the first thing that you do.
Yes.
And you run these parallelly. You do an MRI scan and parallelly you look at the endocrine evaluation. Once you get your endocrine evaluation and your MRI, then you can consider what added investigations you want to do. If you feel that this is likely to be an ectopic lesion, then you look for other systemic sources. But this is more important in what condition? Where you look for ectopics.
In multiple endocrine neoplasias.
under which condition, which particular hormonal hypersecretion will you consider or look for an ectopic lesion, and under what circumstances will you look for it? Will you look for it in every case or only in certain cases?
If there is established hypercorticillemia, I will look for to differentiate whether it is a central hypercorticillemia or ectopic hypercorticillemia.
In all cases?
Not in all cases, sir. Dexamethasone suppression test.
What dexamethasone suppression test will differentiate a central hypercortisolemia from an ectopic secretion?
A high dose dexamethasone suppression test.
Be very specific with your answers, okay? Don't beat around the bush. See, you again come back to the issue of time. In your exam, the more specific your answers are, the more time you will have with added questions. And that gives you credit. If you keep beating around the bush again and again and again, you will lose a chance to get credit, to earn credit.
Okay, sir.
Okay. In a growth hormone secreting adenoma, what is the probability that you will get ectopic sites of secretion? Is it a high probability or is it a low probability?
It is a low probability.
Exactly. So don't talk about CT chest and CT abdomen and all that.
Okay.
You have to realize that as doctors, we have to order the minimum investigations to reach the diagnosis.
Yes, sir.
Once the diagnosis is there, then we have to see whether the other systems are there. The problem.
Okay.
Yes, so is there an MRI? The MRI?
No, show us the investigation.
Show the investigation.
Radial, endocrine.
Okay, go back to the skull X-ray. Why don't you read the skull X-ray?
Yeah.
Just please read the skull X-ray.
There are at least 10 findings there.
He just flashed past. This is interesting. Now it becomes interesting.
10 findings, if you go below 10, then...
There is enlargement of the frontal sinus and frontal bossing is there. There is dental malocclusion is there. Prognathism is there. There is enlargement of the mandible and dental malocclusion is there. And patient is having the cella floor is enlarged and there is no erosions. Patient is having prominence of the skull thickness has increased.
Skull thickness. What about the soft calvarious tissue?
Soft tissue. Patient is having an just below the mandible, the chin region, there is a soft tissue enlargement.
Go on, keep talking.
Yeah.
So this is the X-ray of the acral parts. There is a spade-like deformity. The transverse diameter of the phalanges and the metacarpals are increased. And there is an increased heel pad thickness. Normal heel pad thickness is less than 25 millimeter. That is 2.5 centimeter. And here in this case, it is more than 5 centimeter. And this is the foot. There is a stoutness of the phalanges of the toes and the metatarsals. And this is the X-ray chest. There is a barrel chest. There's no obvious cardiomegaly. And the vascular markings are prominent. The lung fields are normal. And there is no elongation of the vertebra. So this is a CT brain plane. There is a showing an isodense lesion of size 4x3 centimeter in the cellar region, extending to the suprasellar compartment. and it is occupying the space in between the interpeduncular region and posterior part of the third ventricle. Going at MRI brain, the available images are the sagittal, coronal, and axial images with the T1, T2, and contrast images. Here you can see in cellular supracellular SOL, which is isointense, much homogeneous. It has pushed to the floor of the third ventricle, more on the posterior aspect of the third ventricle.
Okay.
And this is an axial image, contrast image that you can see in homogeneous contrast enhancement. And the lesion has reached in between the interpeduncular fossa. This is a T2 weighted coronal section. Here there is a slight mixed intensity on the superior aspect of the tumor. Here you can see both the supracavernous part and the intracavernous part of the carotid artery. The aortic chiasm is stretched upwards. Bowing of the aortic chiasm is seen. And the floor of the third ventricle is normal in this case. You can see both the intraventricular foramen. This is a coronal contrast.
Can you?
Oh.
Coronal contrast, we can see the snowman appearance where the diaphragm vessel is compressing the tumor in the middle and there is a supracellular extension.
Sheikh, you have a pointer. Can you show us and indicate what you're talking to?
Yes, sir. So this is the diaphragmocellular region. There is a supracellular compartment and the intracellular compartment. And this appearance is called as a snowman appearance.
Diaphragmocell is intact or it is invaded?
It appears to be intact, sir.
Okay, what else on the coronal T2? What else of significance do you want to show us on the coronal T2?
Coronal T2, we can see the carotid artery invasion. Whether it is encased or not, we can see that helps in grading.
Okay. Answer the specific question. Is there extension to the cavernous sinus?
No, sir. The tumor is not extending. No, sir. No, it is not extending into the cavernous sinus, sir.
Good. Can you just zoom the one of the images, the coronal ones?
The coronal contrast. Zoom.
Coronal contrast.
Coronal contrast, sir.
Yeah, just magnify one of those. You should be able to do it. Difficult.
I'll do it.
Okay.
Is it okay, sir?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's fine.
So, how do you know, I accept your answer, there's no cavernous sinus extension, but there seems to be. Okay, what is the how do you grade that cavernous sinus extension? What grading is the usual one, which is?
It is called the NOS grading, sir.
Okay, good. How can you on the coronal scan just put a coronal scan so that he can grade? Can you tell us how the NOS grading is done?
Sir, intercavernous line should be 1 second. Sir. I'll zoom in.
Okay, good. Just zoom in. Zoom one of the images of the coronal, which you can see the carotid.
So So image which shows both the supracavernous part and the intracavernous part should be selected.
Okay. How many grades are there?
There are 4 grades, sir.
Okay. Can you tell us?
So a line which is drawn on the medial aspect of connecting the two carotid arteries, that is called as the medial carotid line, and then there is a median carotid line, and then there is a lateral carotid line. So grade 0 is a tumor which is not extended into the medial carotid line, and grade 1 is extended into the medial carotid line, but it does not cross the medial carotid line. Grade 3 is it has reached the median carotid line, but has not crossed the lateral carotid line, intercarotid line. And grade 4 is it has crossed the lateral carotid line and it has encased the carotid artery completely.
Very good. So, is there any modification of the NOSP grading into another so that now we have 5 grades?
I'm not aware of it. Sorry.
The grade 3 has become grade A, 3A and 3B. So, that you can read about.
Okay. I'll do it.
What is the importance of this grading?
If the carotid artery is encased, so it will be much difficult while doing a transsphenoidal surgery. We may likely to inadvertently we will be injure the carotid artery. We may think that we are on the tumor, but it may.
Is there any Indian author and a prominent neurosurgeon who has this is the cavernous sinus who has developed a grading system for these? For these tumors, and which grade would this be? It's from Dr. Muzumdar's department.
I'm keeping.
This is a very important classification. I must tell you.
Correct.
Very important, especially when you are appearing for an exam.
Yeah.
I'll learn about it, sir. I'm sorry, I don't know.
Goel's classification. You must read about Goel's classification.
Yes, sir. Sure.
And so what grade this tumor would be? Is this a giant tumor? Can you just zoom this, the coronal image once so that he can see properly? All the coronal images, not the single section.
Yes.
Yeah, just zoom this a bit. Is this a giant tumor? And so what are giant tumors?
It's based on the Wilson-Hardy classification. The suprasellar extension, it has just reached the floor of the third ventricle, but it has not displaced or elevated the floor of the third ventricle. Again, there's no evidence of any hydrocephalus. So, the size of the lesion will be probably between 4 centimeters. It is not a giant tumor, sir.
Okay, good. So, how approach?
Pardon me, sir. I couldn't hear you, sir.
What would you like to do?
Treatment.
Since this is compressive lesion with visual deficits, I would like to operate on the patient, sir. I will explain
Which operation?
What kind of?
What surgery?
Endoscopic transnasal transseptal transsphenoidal excision of the lesion, sir.
Okay,
both the endoscopic as well as microscopic combination of both.
Okay, so this patient gets is under your follow-up. These are COVID times and you told him to wait for a couple of months, and after 1 month the patient says, I have had very severe headache and my vision is rapidly going down. And you bring the patient to your ER, the patient tests COVID positive. What do you do?
This scenario is a case of pituitary apoplexy, sir. I will operate on the patient immediately.
Which approach? COVID positive?
COVID positive.
Would you like to wait for another 2-3 weeks or would you like to wait?
No, sir. Since he has got an imminent visual deterioration, and he may have a hypothalamic compression and it may even endanger his life. So I'll go for an emergency surgery, sir. I'll decompress. I'll take all precautionary measures for COVID, and I'll go for the surgery through transcranial endoscopy.
Don't take too much of risk. Go transcranial. You'll do a good job. At least COVID positive with too much of rhinocerebral mucormycosis coming in and all that. It's better to go to a transcranial, especially with a COVID positive, losing vision rapidly.
How will you know that this patient has responded to your surgery immediately after surgery? Is there any
patient will have
whether a surgery is successful or not, apart from the vision?
Immediately
after surgery, in the evening, the patient will tell you something. If you ask, you mentioned in the history also that particular symptom. When you decompress, he may say, yes, vision is better and all. But what about his acromegaly feature?
Connective tissue, I mean, the fluid, extracellular fluid will be relieved. A sense of well-being will be there.
Sense of well-being everybody will have depending upon how the surgery goes. But anything specific in your history which will tell you, the patient will tell you something, you know. But you have to ask him, what about the hands and feet? Anything he will tell you regarding the hands and feet? Something?
Feeling lighter.
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 You mentioned in your symptom, you had mentioned that he complained of this. Moistness, sweaty palms. So he will say that, you know, that something which happens immediately or it will be most gratifying for him.
Okay, you've done a beautiful surgery. The patient is fine. And when do you send the growth hormone sample? What will you tell your resident? You've done a gross total, a so-called gross total excision. Endonasal approach, patient is feeling good. And what will you tell your resident? When would you like to get an MR? And when would you like to get the hormone evaluation?
Yes, sir. There will be a reduction in the growth hormone level by 30-40% by the 48th hour, sir. And the normalization of insulin-like growth factor 1 immediately after 24-48 hours after surgery. So I'd like to do an basal hormone level at 48 hours of surgery, and MR also I'll do after 48 hours, sir. Because that will
usually most of the centers are practicing the growth hormone next day morning. That is the usual protocol, growth hormone next day morning. The IGF-1 takes time to come down. So the IGF-1 is not the important hormone to be evaluated. Yeah. Usually assessed after a month, and then serially, it usually starts dropping after a month. And then an early MRI, if you have an early MRI, that's good. But if you're putting in some lot of packing material and all that, it's always better. You can get it done even after 6 weeks. But otherwise, within 5 days, it is good enough. Any other questions or we can wrap up?
Suppose there is residue and growth hormone doesn't come down, then what? Then the endocrinologist will be on your head. If the growth hormone doesn't come down or significantly as what is expected, then what is the next plan?
If sufficient decompression is achieved, I'll watchfully wait, sir, for the reduction of growth hormones.
And suppose on the scan you see some residue, or there is some recurrence after some time, then what is the plan?
I'll try with some medical treatment, sir. I'll put the patient on dopamine agonist and subcutaneous sublimation of somatostatin analogs like octreotide if it's affordable.
If not affordable, then?
I'll go for cambergolin and bromocriptine. Cambergolin is more patient complaint.
Any alternative modality of treatment would you consider apart from the? Would you consider reoperation, or you consider any other treatment?
I'll go for radiotherapy, sir.
Before you go in for radiotherapy or for gamma knife or for surgery, I think it's very important, especially all our exam wings. The 2016 and the 2020 classifications have changed massively, especially in pituitary adenomas, with the introduction of transcription factors and all. Must go through that. There's a shortage of time. We don't want to go into the. So this is a lot of subsets in which you have. We have to be these are no longer the hormonal somatotroph type of a class. So we have to go to the molecular level.
Molecular markers. Molecular markers need to be done in this.
Very important. And then a repeat MRI and maybe a resurgery. Because and then if, your usual protocol is if there is a residual tumor in growth hormone, we usually go in for a second surgery. Yeah. Radiosurgery and radiotherapy is less effective for any hormonal tumors like Cushing's.
Exactly.
Prolactinoma is medical therapy. But we usually go for two surgeries, a repeat one for a growth hormone. We usually even go for three surgeries for Cushing's disease. And then only we resort to gamma knife or SR, any other form of SRS. So are we, the time is done. I think we are pretty late. Anything else?
I think.
Very good.
Yeah, no,
Manas.
By both the rest.
Yeah, I know.
And I think my only input is, Sheikh, you presented very, very nicely. But the slit lamp, you see, such small things, please try to avoid in the exam because it actually goes against you. Problem is that it usually takes away a lot of positive things that you create in your presentation.
Yeah.
So, examiners don't forget. That is the problem because it's human memory. You always forget. So don't let the examiner remember your bad things. So that is what I always tell all my students, especially all my residents at Ames, that don't let the examiner remember anything about your presentation.
And if you don't know anything, just say, I don't know, just so that you can go to the next question.
Yeah, that's the best thing.
That's better.
Thank you, sir.
Let the examiner remember your positive points rather than negative points.
Yes, sir. I'll change it.
Done.
Yeah.
Okay. So
over to.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, Dr. Dilip had to tell some. No. Dilip, some last comments. No. Now this is the first time you could come.
Ashish has Ashish and Dattatreya have actually said it very nicely. See, the candidates have to. There is no ideal case presentation anywhere. The candidates have to learn from each and every case. There will be mistakes. You just have to try to minimize the mistakes. Keep your presence of mind. So few pointers, keep your presence of mind. Don't get confused. Don't get phased. Because there will be, like I said, there will be questions coming at you from different sides. Don't get confused. Keep your mind clear. Think before you talk. Don't talk as a knee-jerk reaction because then you will end up saying something that you regret. Thirdly, in the exam particularly, keep track of time. Like I said, you have to be aware of it and maximize the time that you use for to earn credit, not to just scrape through the exam. You earn credit. So use that. Don't confabulate. Don't bluff. Be very specific. Answer to the point. And if you don't know anything, say, I don't know and move on.
That's the best. That's the best.
Yes, that's the best.
Absolutely. And one last thing, especially these are COVID times, we are not seeing a lot of patients, especially the residents. Most of them are posted in COVID wards and all. And the patient examination has really come down. So I think this is a great effort by Manas, Dr. Manas and team.
Yeah.
And try to see, okay, whatever chance we get between the spikes, please examine the cases. Because unless you do it yourself, it becomes very shaky in the exams and maybe for future as well. So I think there's nothing, there's no online, you cannot examine online.
That is
to do it yourself. So true.
Yeah. This is the first time we could complete both cases. Though we had crossed time, half an hour, I'd like to thank all the faculty who spent on a Saturday evening and that to half an hour more. And I'd like to thank Dr. Dilip, Dr. Majumdar, and Dr. Ashish for spending time in teaching, and we'll request many more times. I hope you'll not mind.
Not at all.
Fun loving teacher.
Actually, we learn a lot through every consciously or unconsciously. You know, we just learn through all this.
We learn a lot from the students while presenting.
Yes,
also.
Yes, absolutely. And
many of the doubts we had also get clarified.
Correct.
While asking.
The first case was very good. Actually, when the findings are less, then you think more.
The first
case was good. There was a lot of discussion on headache, a lot of discussion on vision. So the simpler the
case, like to thank,
the more difficult the discussion becomes.
I'd like to thank Dr. Vivek and Dr. Sheikh and Dr. Ashutosh for coming forward to present, because people usually are very hesitant to present, and they don't want to get raped by the examiners in front of everybody.
I hope all the chat box questions are answered. So most of them are answered.
All of them, I think, yes. I
like to thank Dr. Suchanda for moderating, and Dr. Chirag for coordinating. And Chirag, you should again find people who are to present next time.
Yes.
Next time, we have to decide whether we have to do OSCE or case presentation, depending on what is the pattern of exam they're planning to do. And Professor Nair, Suresh Nair, is there to give any comments, last comments, or is left? Professor Nair, Suresh,
is there?
No.
Sir is not there. Not there.
No, he's left.
Okay. So before I conclude, I'd like to thank Mr. Sriram from ICON, who look after the logistics, and be all the time they are there and do it well. And with these few words, I request all the audience to be there next time, first Friday of every month at 7:30 p.m. People who are interested to present are first Saturday of every month.
Yes.
And people who are interested to present.
You said Friday. Why don't you shift to Friday?
Sorry.
Friday students are will be free, madam.
Students will not be free.
Subconsciously, one on Friday. Make it Friday.
No. I can get Suchanda's thing, you know, family pressure coming.
Yeah. And
agreed.
So we cannot change. For the students, it's on Saturday only.
Okay.
With this few words, good night, and we'll meet again when we invite you again.
Sure. Bye, good night. Bye. Wonderful session. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you all. Bye.